Hello and welcome to Tensile Ground Coffee, a few minutes on ground engineering to enjoy it while having your coffee. Well, here we are in the famous train street in Hanoi, Vietnam, where the trains run along the street. That gives me an ideal opportunity to describe to you the functions of the different components of railway track, superstructure and substructure. Now, I'm told that no trains are due at the moment, but I'm not relying on that, of course. I've got a safe system of work in place. I'm acting as lookout that way in case any trains come that way. And Brian, you're looking that way, aren't you, in case any trains come from the other direction. Okay, so let's describe the different components. So here we have a rail that acts like a beam. That distributes the load along across about four or five sleepers, and of course it supports and guides the wheels of the train. Then we have the sleepers or cross ties. So these ones are made of concrete, they can be made of wood or steel, and they distribute the load that way. And around them we have the track ballast. This is a coarse, angular, granular material. That gives it a lot of strength to resist lateral and longitudinal movement of the sleepers. And there's a layer of ballast beneath the sleepers, typically about 300 millimeters or 1 foot thick, that supports the sleepers and distributes the load down. So the grading gives it large voids. That's useful for several reasons. That's very good for drainage of water down through the ballast. And it also allows storage of foul material that might come from abrasion of the ballast or any fines that are coming in, and they can be removed by cleaning later on. It also provides good damping properties for the dynamic track loads to provide a smoother ride. And it makes it easier for correcting the line and level of the track. Either with a tamper or manually, you can jack the track, then you can pack this ballast material underneath the ballast to hold it in place. Now, traditionally, the ballast was placed directly on the subgrade, but more modern tracks now have a sub-ballast layer beneath the ballast. So that is a more graded material, so it's a bit cheaper than the railway ballast. But that has several functions. That, as well, of course, distributing the load, because it has is more graded, it has smaller voids, so that directs water from the ballast away from the subgrade, at the same time allowing any water coming up from the subgrade also to be drained out as well. And it also prevents mixing of the ballast and the subgrade. So it prevents ballast penetrating into the subgrade and prevents fines from the from the subgrade coming up through into the ballast. And all those functions can also be performed by various geosynthetic products. Now, finally, the sub-ballast is where the design element comes in. You design the depth of the sub-ballast to distribute the load satisfactorily to the subgrade, depending on the strength of the subgrade. Now, of course, geogrid is very suited to this granular material for stabilizing it. So you can place geogrid at the base of the ballast layer, so 300 millimeters below the sleepers, clear of the tamping zone, but it stabilizes that whole layer so that we get less movement of the ballast, so less wearing down, attrition of it, and producing of foul material, and you need less track maintenance. It maintains the track position for longer. And you can also place geogrid in the sub-ballast layer. That gives it more strength again, so it maintains the track geometry for longer. Or you can use a thinner layer of sub-ballast during construction to save money at the construction stage. Okay, I hope that was a useful overview for you of the different components of a railway track. That's all for this episode of Tensile Ground Coffee. Thanks for watching and see you next time.